Well, good morning. It's good to see you this morning. We are talking about listening today. These are the quietest services I've ever had. It's unbelievable. This is service number 6 since I started the series. It's only second week, but we have a few years. Anyway, so it's been funny though. Every service, everybody's like, I guess it's on listening, so I better listen. So it's been good. You know, let me just give a little disclaimer before I start this message, and that is this. This is something I really struggle with. Being a hyperactive ADHD, if you want to call it that, person, I struggle with waiting. But I want you to know that if I can learn how to spend time getting still, listening to God, and waiting on God. If I can learn, still learning, how to wait and listen to people, then you can. And even beyond that, it is an absolute miracle that God would use this series. Every service, somebody's come to me and said, that really helped me. I had some folks come up to me after last service, and they said, you know, it was almost like they were visiting for the first time, and they said this is basically exactly what they needed. And I said, it's amazing how God does that. So now we're going to be talking about listening and waiting. And here's the deal about listening. We don't always say what we mean. There's a man walking down the street with his mule and his dog. So this must have been in Mims. So he's walking down the street with his mule and his dogs, and there you go. So as they're walking down the street, have you seen anybody out there with a mule? Is there a mule? There's mules at Mims. Yes, there are. Our neighbor has a mule. At first they were like, that's a slant. Well, no, I just saw that yesterday. So they're walking down the street with their mule and their dog, and there's a farmer driving down the street in his pickup truck, and he's texting. You should not text and drive, but he's texting, and he clips all three of them. Gets the mule, clips the dog. It's a joke, so don't get upset about these. You guys had an emotional reaction. It's getting worse. So he clips all three of them. They're laying in the ditch, and the farmer gets out, and the dog is yelping and making noise. So the farmer feels bad for the dog, so he wants to put it out of its misery. He goes back to his truck, gets his shotgun, and bang, kills the dog. Looks at the mule's leg's broken. So the farmer thinks, well, I'm going to do the humane thing. Kills the dog. Looks at the guy and goes, are you okay? The guy says, I'm fine. But let me tell you something. Just because somebody says it's fine doesn't mean it's not. And for those of you who are newlyweds or clueless men, let me tell you something. When your wife says it's fine, it probably doesn't mean fine, okay? So that's why part of listening and waiting is looking and realizing that a lot of how we communicate is nonverbal. A lot of what we say isn't what we say, it's what we mean by what we say. And so we have to tune in, pay attention to people. And so I'm going to look at some principles today, but here's what I want to talk about, okay? Today, the summary of the message is this. I want you and I to learn how, when we're going through a time of waiting, and I know some of you are going through a time of waiting right now. There's something in your life, you're waiting on God to answer. Or you see a situation with somebody and you're in that waiting period. Or you're in a relationship with somebody and you don't see things changing and you don't really know what to do. And when you're going through that time of waiting, I want to encourage you to begin to wait with expectation. And when you're waiting on God, to begin to listen with expectation, kind of like a farmer that's working his crop. So you're waiting to hear what God might say. And then the second thing we're going to talk about is listening to others and listening with expectation. What are they really saying? What can I get out of this? What can I do about it? So we're going to start with this first part. Number one, why do I need to wait on God? Now, I don't know about you, but I wish God was on my time clock. I'm the kind of person that puts microwave popcorn in the microwave, and I tend to come back and look at the microwave before it's done and think, why is this popcorn taking 2.5 minutes? Right? And many of us are that way, and we've developed this lifestyle. I got stuck. I went to a play, took Lydia for her birthday to the play Wicked, which is phenomenal, by the way. And we were leaving the thing. There were 4 cars in front of me to turn right onto a major road there. Took 10 minutes for 4 cars to move. I found myself just going, you know, and I started thinking of all the reasons how they could redo, like I have something to do with Orlando traffic, and how a policeman should be there, and I was giving advice to no one, right? To no one, I'm giving advice, and nobody's listening to me. It's in my head, by the way, and I'm not saying it out loud. Lydia's sitting next to me. She could care less. She's over there with the book Wicked going, ha, 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 you know. And I'm thinking, you know, they really should have policemen here pushing the button and blah, blah, blah. And then we take our, and then I'm going to have to take a left. And then I'm running through all this, and I am wasting my life focusing on the wrong things and being in such a hurry that if I'm not careful, I don't pay attention to the person that's next to me or in front of me or to God. In life, you're going to have to wait on God sometimes. And you're like me, and you say, well, why? If God is a miraculous God, why doesn't he just instantly fix stuff the way I want him to? Because, you know, if I was in charge, everything would be better. So we're going to look at a few things. Number one, God is using... Hang on. Sorry. Just got an error message. Nice. God is using your waiting to renew your strength. There are times in life that emotionally or physically, even spiritually, that you may get tired. And you know, we're watching football games. I know there's one lady here who you cannot tell what team she's rooting for. Amy Sue Lovis, you look like an advertisement for the Green Bay Packers today. But even the best team on earth, the 1984 Miami Hurricanes, even the best team on earth, the best player on the best team has to rest. Smart coaches sit their players. I can tell when a coach is not good, when they think, I'm just going to leave my best player in the whole time. Even Michael Jordan had to sit down and rest. And so who do you and I think we are that we don't need rest? We don't need time to recuperate. We think that I've gone through this hard time and I should just be better tomorrow. If you don't have a favorite verse, this might be it. This might be a new one for you. Isaiah 40:31 says this, but those who wait for the Lord shall be frustrated. I'm sorry, I changed that in my Bible. Is that okay? Right? Hey, come on. Let's be honest. Those who wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. What strength? Physical? Spiritual strength? Emotional strength? They'll mount up with wings like eagles. They'll run and not be weary. They will walk and not faint. And we love the end of that verse because we're like, yes, I'm going to be stronger. But we don't like the wait. This word for wait is where I got this idea, the context of the message. This word wait in the Hebrew is the idea of expectancy. It's the idea of when you're waiting to expect God to do something. When you're listening to somebody to expect to hear something you need to hear or see something you need to see and not just let life run by you and not pay attention, because we all need to wait. We don't like to wait. I talked to 2 different nurses about this, so I'm pretty sure it's accurate or they're liars. When you break an arm, how many of you have broken a bone? You've broken a bone in your life? I never have. I can put my hands down. I don't know how I'm going to encourage you to raise your hand. But anyway, I've broken a lot of other things. But anyway, so I have a friend who I broke 3 of his toes on 1 youth trip. 3 different times. Anyway, that's another story. So sorry, Mike Peterson. Anyway, so the good news is he has a good sense of humor. Bad news is it's my fault that he has good sense of humor. Anyway, so, but when you break a bone, do you realize that if the doctors really, if you have like a broken arm, they could just tape it and splint it? Do Do you know why they put a cast on you? Because they don't trust you. Especially Jack. Jack, you would take, you probably try to take your own cast off if you ever had a broken bone. You know, and the, Jack, I've picked on you 2 weeks this year already. So the truth is, by the way, I've had people, how many of you tried to take your own cast off? I just got to see in this crowd. I thought there'd be at least one. Okay, so the truth is they don't trust you. Why? Because we don't like to rest. We don't like to be still. We don't like to be quiet. And so what is he doing? Sometimes it's just the time that we need to be renewed. Don't be frustrated that you're not where you want to be spiritually. Don't be frustrated that you're not where you want to be emotionally. Maybe you've been through a hard time and emotionally you don't have your act together yet. It's okay. Here's what I want you to pray. God, would you renew my strength during this waiting time? And I did this sermon last night, and on the way home, I went by Publix and I got one item and I got in the 10 item lane. There was one lady in front of me. She used coupons. Then she used, ready? Three different forms of payment. Three, I didn't know you could use, by the way, you could use three different forms of payment. Just don't go through the 10 items or less line. Right, you with me? And I'm there and I can see the people behind me. And I thought about this message and I just started laughing. I'm like, this is it. This is it. Did God know that was going to happen? Yes, absolutely. Boop. This is a test. And we fail retake after retake after retake. And God's like, I'll just give it to you again. Now, this is the same guy. This is the same guy who wanted to be impatient with that lady who accidentally, before the hurricane, got in that line with 30 items and didn't see the little sign that said 10 and had people behind him going, I'm so sorry, you want me to get it, I'm sorry. Right? That's me, but now I'm impatient with somebody else. Why? Because it's not me. Sometimes we just have to wait and we have to say, God, give me strength in the waiting time. So it's funny, last night I'm in line, I'm like, oh Lord, just bless me in the waiting time. How y'all doing tonight? I was good till now. Everybody else only had two items too. She had 12. Number two. He's teaching you to trust him. This is such a parental answer. He's teaching you to trust him. Now listen to what Jesus does, okay? So Jesus is telling his disciple what's going to happen after he goes to heaven. They're going to receive the Holy Spirit. Now, don't you think that God can do things in a hurry if he wants to? Exactly. That's how we all feel. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, Jesus gave them this command. Don't leave Jerusalem, but, what's the next word? Let's try it again because some of you forgot how to read, okay? But, for the gift my Father promised, which you heard me speak about, for John baptized with water, but in a few days, you'll be baptized with the Holy Spirit. Why a few days? What? I mean, you're God. Why does it have to be a few days? Why do they have to wait a few days? By the way, there were people that were trying to kill them, remember? Jesus had just been crucified not that long before. There were still people who didn't like him. And you're going to wait in the town where they crucified Jesus? Yes. Absolutely. You're going to trust me. But I don't like it. And you don't like it. We tend to want control. We want to know what's going to happen tomorrow and the next day and the next day. We try to plan our lives, but all these interruptions take place. And so what do? We try to gain control. So what do people do? So they go and they read their horoscope thinking, well, maybe this person can tell me, when the stars align, your kindness and love and somebody caring will come into your life. Or we go, even worse, to a palm reader and have them tell us what our future is. Why? Because we don't trust God. Because we think we can trust somebody else. By the way, the Bible warns about those things, just so you know. It just shows, who am I trusting? Am I going to trust some newspaper reporter that got a computer out and made a random generation of something? Or some person who can't handle their own life and is trying to tell me how to handle mine. By the way, that's my life story. But let me context this. I don't tell you what I say about life. I try to tell you what the Bible says about life. That's the reason a donkey can be used by God, just so you know. I saw this prayer a few years ago, and this is a great prayer for you to pray for this idea. God, I don't always understand you, but I trust you. You may not understand what's happening in your life right now. You may not understand why everything seemed to go wrong and things are messed up and that thing's not happening the way you think it should, or why you're in this position right now. God, I don't understand you, but I trust you. So he does it to renew our strength. He does it to teach us to trust. And number three, he is showing you that he is in control. And I had to add this. I couldn't leave it out. And you're not. And you're not. And you're not. So would you do me a favor and just tell the person next to you that they're not in control. Ready? Go. I have never in my life had people enjoy that so much. That's, you are not in control, right? Couples who got in fights on the way here, really, I heard the emphasis. You are not. If you said it like this, then forgiveness is what you need to work on today. But here's the deal for you and for me. I'm not in control. As much as I think I'm in control, I'm not in control. I'm not always in control. And I'm not in control at all. God, I do what I'm called to do, but you know what? God knows the future. One of my favorite verse in the Old Testament and my favorite story in the Old Testament is Exodus. It's in Exodus chapter 14. And here's the scene. Most of you know the background of it. You've seen Charlton Heston. And it's Moses. He goes into the promised lands, let my people go. There's plagues. The Israelites see all this stuff. They see God do miraculous things. And then finally, Pharaoh says, okay, I'm going to let you go. So he lets them go. They come to their first I'm going to go ahead and read the verse since it's on the screen already. All right? But Moses told the people, don't be afraid. Just be still and watch the Lord rescue you today. The Egyptians you see today will never be seen again. The Lord himself will fight for you. Just stay calm. See, right before this, what happened is they came up to the Red Sea. And so they came up to the Red Sea. It was their very first obstacle. Their first, not their second, not their third. They'd seen all these miracles, these awesome things happen. They come to the Red Sea and they start saying, do you know how to swim? Anybody here bring wood for a bridge? Anybody? Right? Anybody got floaties? Floaties? Anybody? Right? So any way to cross? There's no way to cross. So what do? They start freaking out. And then Pharaoh's army, chariots, some of the only chariots at the time, are coming at them and they start freaking out. Do you blame them? Do you blame them? Except that they had just seen God do miraculous things. And so they started saying, we want to go back. We don't like this. We want out. I've had enough. I mean, we waited a whole 20 seconds here. And he says to them, stand still. That word for stand still also means be quiet. Some of you are quiet on the outside. If I was to describe you, I would call you a quiet person. But on the inside, you're not. You're troubled, and you're struggling, and you're stressing, and you're freaking out. And God is saying, listen, trust me. In the middle of all this, you can trust me. I'm in control. Do you know the worst thing a parent can do for a child is to give them everything they ask for right when they ask for it? Because what begins to happen is the child thinks they're in control. So they think, I'm in charge of you. You're not in charge of me. Don't you tell me what to do. So those are the kids you see. Now, I'm not talking about special needs kids because I understand that's a whole different category. But the truth is, when you give a child everything they want, special needs or not, and you give them all the time everything they want, they begin to think they're in charge of you instead of you're in charge of them. Even your animals will do that. Especially your animals, right? And here's the deal for children. You think by doing that you'll make them happy, but instead all you'll make them is spoiled and unhappy. And God knows the same about you. Because sometimes we need to wait on him to realize I'm not in control. That delayed gratification. I don't always get what I want when I want it. God doesn't answer my prayer just the way I wanted it. God's not a genie that you rub the lamp and go, these are the things I want. There it is, bang. No, because then we would be less happy and we would think that we're in control. God wants us to know that He is in control. So I want to encourage you, when you feel out of control and you feel like your life is out of control, or you try to control life, to thank God. God, thank you that I'm not in control, but you are. But you are. So not only does He do it to renew our strength or teach us to trust Him or that He's in control, finally, He does this so that we can know and have faith that God is always, number four, I can have faith that God is always working in my life. This is a navel orange tree, one of the farmers that's part of our grove owners, that's part of our Rotary group in Cocoa, brought us all navel oranges a few weeks ago. I love navel oranges. There's less and less. They're more and more expensive because of some things happening. But even orange trees, as this year comes and the harvest begins to come, they begin to look dead. A couple of weeks ago, I had a rose bush in my backyard that wasn't growing well, wasn't getting enough sunlight, and I've got some roses in my front yard, and I thought, I'm going to replant that. Actually, been a few months ago. So I dug it up, and I went out front, and I planted it where a rose bush had died in the middle, and I planted it. Just a few weeks ago, I looked, and that thing was dead. There were no leaves. It was all brown, and I thought the soil must be bad. You know, that's why the other one died, and I had all these excuses for why it wasn't my fault, right? And then this week, when I was pruning my other roses, I looked over, and I noticed a new shoot with leaves on that rose. And I realized, you know, that rose has been alive the whole time. The roots have been growing. There's been work going on, and I didn't even know it. And here's the truth in your life and in my life. Even when you feel like God's not working, He's working. Even when you feel like God's not answering, He's answering, and He's moving in your life, and He's changing things, and He's working in situations, and He's working in those people that you think. And by the way, sometimes when you pray and ask God to move, things get worse. That rose bush, when I transplanted it, some of you have been through this in your life, you've been transplanted. You've gone through a divorce. You've gone through a bankruptcy. You've gone through being fired at work. You've gone through a struggle at home. You've gone through something. Maybe you lost a loved one and all the leaves fall off and you think, where is God? And I want you to know that regardless of what's going on in your life right now, He is still working. He is still working. It may not feel like it. It may feel like He is far away, but He is close and He cares about you. Listen to what David said in the book of Psalms. David was a king, Old Testament king. He was the forerunner of Christ. That's a long story, but basically Jesus was in the line of David. But David is attacked. David made some huge mistakes. David had people attack him. And here's what he prays and sings. Though I'm surrounded by trouble, You'll protect me from the anger of my enemies. I don't know about you, I don't like people to be angry at me. These people wanted to kill Him. You reach out Your hand and the power of Your right hand saves me. The Lord, I love this, will work. What's that? What does that mean? It means He's still working. It's active. The Lord will work out His plans for my life, for Your faithful Lord, O Lord, endures forever. You may feel like David did that you're surrounded by trouble, but I want you to know that God has not stopped working, and thank Him. That's the one thing you can do. Thank Him that He is still working. Now, here's a couple of practical things, reminders when you're waiting on God. Trust God when you don't have an answer. It's okay not to know everything. Did you know that? I have my doctorate degree, for those of you who don't know that. Some of you are like, really? Like, yeah, you go to school enough, they'll finally give it to you, okay? That's what happens, right? And so people will come to me and they'll ask me a question and think, I know the answer. And they'll say, you know, I'm wondering, you know, why does God do this? Or why is this happening in my life? And sometimes I can kind of give them a verse or something that says, but there's times where I look at them and I go, huh, no idea. No idea. We don't always understand God, and it's okay. Number two, we need to read God's Word to discover His voice and His character. You are helping with the sermon today, aren't you? All right, so we can read God's Word. Here's the deal. You and I need to find our boundary line. We need to find out who God is through His Word. That is the authority for our Christian life, is to understand what does God's Word, written Word, say about it. Number three, then we can check what we hear and think against the Bible. Some of you believe terrible things about God. because somebody told you God hates your guts, or that God wants to beat you up, or that sin is okay and it doesn't matter what you do as long as you're a nice person. Listen, you need to read God's word and spend time in his word, because some of you also believe lies that go through your head all the time, that you're worthless, that you don't matter. You do matter. You're a special creation of God. You're his chosen. He wants you to go to heaven. He sent Jesus so that nobody would have to die. Nobody would have to perish. Why? Because he loves you. That's what the verse says, John 3:16, because he loves you. So check what you're saying, even to yourself, against what God's saying. And check what you're saying about others compared to what God says about them. And then take time to get still. If I can take time every morning to spend time in God's word, to spend time in prayer, you can too. I have a little book called 2959 that I love to use. I don't use it all the time, but I'm using it this year. You can buy it up at Park Avenue. It's just a prayer journal, but there's tons of prayer journals. Get something to spend time to help you to focus. And finally, prepare yourself to act as you wait. Waiting is not about just waiting. It's saying, God, I want to grow close to you, even in the waiting. This next quote is by Bonhoeffer, who's a great theologian. He said this: he who can no longer listen to his brother will soon be no longer listening to God either. He'll be doing nothing but prattle in the presence of God too. This is the beginning of the death of the spiritual life. Why? Because there's two commands: love God and love people. If you're not loving people, you don't really love God. So let's look at how keys to waiting and listening to others. So I'm just going to give you three things. They come from Philippians chapter 2, and here they are. From Proverbs, at first it says, number one, we need to ask God to help you to value others with his eyes. If you don't value other people, you are not going to listen to them. And the truth is, if you're really honest, if somebody's talking to you and you're really not listening, you have made them feel like they don't matter. So one of the important things is, even if you think somebody matters, if you're not treating them that way, you're saying to them they don't. Fools do not want to understand anything. They only want to tell others what they think. Now, for those of you who've been here very long, you've heard me tell this story that I worked at a plant nursery in Orlando. And what I did is I took little plants and put them in big pots and then put dirt that sat in this big pan of dirt. And we had ladies, three different guys and three different ladies. And basically they would bring us small plants and then they would take the big plants back. So they had a little cart, looked like a wagon. They would bring the little plants. And so the guys next to me, their lady would bring the plants right behind them, drop them off, put them back, and they'd just take their time walking back. My lady would come and go to the other side of the pile, drop the little plants off, come over and get the big plants, and then carry them back to her cart. So after a few days of this, I said, I wonder if she realizes she can come right here. So I said to her, hey, you know you can pull your cart up right here. What? You pull your cart up. Don't try to tell me what to do. You're new here. Okay, but it would be easier for you. I have a system. What? I have a system. That's the way I do it. Now, I didn't say anything else, but I'm thinking, this is the stupidest system. Sorry if you don't like that word, but I didn't know what I was saying. So the truth is, we all are that way sometimes. We have systems, ways we've done things, ways we've acted towards people. We like to say, well, that's just the way I am. Yep, I'm just one of these people, likes to speak my mind. Well, your mind's not that sharp, so quit. Most of the people who tell you they love to tell their opinion is not worth telling. Fools love to tell everybody what they think, but they don't want to understand anything. We need to make sure that we are listening and not just talking. Not just trying to tell other people what we think, but receiving and listening and learning. Philippians 2, verse 3, the first part, it says, when you do things, don't let selfishness or pride be your guide. So what do you need to do? Humility helps you to value others. So the prayer you need to pray is, God, would you help me to be humble, to value other people, to value their opinion? Number two, recognize that you can learn from anyone. You know that person that you think they are dumb as a bag of hammers, or the bag of hammers is smarter than they are, right? That person you can learn from. In Philippians 2, verse 3, the second part, it says, instead, Be humble, listen, and give more honor to others than yourself. Give honor to others more than yourself. So, do you realize you can learn from anyone? And if you value people, you're going to listen to them. You're going to be interested in what they say. And sometimes, can I be honest with you? Sometimes in listening to somebody, even if their opinion's dumb, okay? Can I tell you something? What that lady said was not smart. I mean, why would you do that instead of that? There's not. But as you listen to people, you learn. You know what? Over the years, that person had been hurt. And they had been hurt by people who told them what to do, and they just didn't want to be controlled anymore, so they wouldn't listen to people. You can learn even from people who, for whatever reason, are doing that, and you can learn about them. Number three, finally, cultivate a genuine interest in others. Philippians 2:4, don't be interested in your own life only, but be interested in the lives of others. Are you really interested in other people's lives, or are you just passing time when you talk to them? Are you really interested in what they're saying and about them personally, or what they're saying? And let me tell you this, listen, and I wish I could do this because some of you would love it. Imagine if I could have Tom Hanks just walk into church and he came in and said, Eric, I'd like to share a couple of minutes about some things I'm doing out at the Space Center. Now, I would not interrupt Tom Hanks. Would you? I would say, no, you take a few minutes. And I can tell you right now, most of you, all of you, would listen more carefully than you're listening now. Why? Because you would value that. Hey, there are people in your home that should be more important to you than Tom Hanks. There are people in your workplace that should be more valuable to you than Tom Hanks. And so, can you value their opinion? Can when they talk, you say, God, would you help me to really value them? Why? Because Proverbs 18:4 says it, spoken words can be like deep water, but wisdom is like a flowing spring. To get to deep water, what do you got to do? You got to dig a well. You got to get a bucket. You know, back in the Old Testament times, it was not easy to get water. And yet they did. And they're saying, hey, if you really want to find out what people are all about, what are their motives? Who are they? Then you have to listen to them. And listening requires waiting. Now, I want you to learn to listen with expectation like a farmer. When you're praying and asking God to move in an area, to listen and say, God, I'm willing to wait. I don't like it, but I'm willing to wait on you. But also when you listen to other people, to listen in expectation, to pay attention to what they're saying, expecting that God can use that. And we're not going to look at these points at the end, so you can go all the way to that last slide, Judy, if you would. Otherwise, you guys will read them all. They're in your notes. But here's what I want you to imagine. Imagine if you could go through life really paying attention and waiting on God, so that when you were in line at Publix and things didn't go the way you wanted to, or you were caught in traffic and things didn't want go the way you wanted to, or if you had a crying baby in the middle of church that was distracting the pastor, and you could say, God, I know there's a purpose for that baby crying the whole time, so would you teach me, we did this on purpose, by the way, would you teach me, she's pinching the baby. So God, would you teach me what you're trying to teach me instead of me thinking how I can fix that? What would your life be like if you really began to trust God with all of these distractions? What if you began to trust God with all of the detours? Would your life be full of peace? And then with the people at home and the people that you work with, what if you really began to value them so that when you listened to them, you gave them love? That you received God's love and then you gave them His love. We have our time of giving in just a minute, but you might be here today and you've never given your life to Jesus Christ. I want to encourage you today. I'll be here after the service, and you might come to me and say, Eric, I don't know what it means to be a Christian. Or you might come to me and you might say, Eric, I know about Christianity. I know what it means to be a Christian, but I've never done it, and I'm ready to surrender my life to Christ. I'd love to pray with you and talk about that. But maybe like me, you're here today and you realize, Eric, I really need to work on listening. I really need to work on valuing other people and not getting frustrated at every little thing, but receiving wisdom and patience and being able to wait when it comes to other people. Being able to wait when it comes to listening to God. And that may just be your prayer today as we sing this last song. Let's go to the Lord in prayer today. Father, thank you so much that we can wait on you. Lord, I am not very patient. And Lord, I don't like to wait. But Father, you said as we wait on you, you renew our strength. Lord, as we wait in expectation for you, that new things will spring up in our lives. So Lord, we trust that you're going to do that. And Lord, when the distractions in our lives come, when the detours come, I pray that you would remind us that even in those times, you are still working. Even when it seems like things aren't going the way we think they should, that Father, you are working behind the scenes. And Lord, for that one person here today who's praying for a friend, or they're praying for a situation, and they feel like everything has died and everything has fallen apart, Lord, that you would renew their strength today, that they'd be able to hear you. Father, even in this waiting time, that they be able to be a blessing and show others your love. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to end with a closing song today in our time of giving. You give what God's put on your heart today. Thanks for being here.